staff, and the key there, of course, is Dwight Gooden. The Doc finished with 24 wins last season, pulling in every award in the book, and barring anything unforeseen, he should continue to dominate National League hitters. Rounding out the staff, Ron Darling, 16-6 last year, and he should continue to improve. And slim Sid Fernandez, despite going 9-9, looked impressive in most outings and had a good spring. And Rick Aguilera at 10-7 and 85 should fit right in with the Mets rotation, showing lots of promise his rookie year. While the starters look solid, the bullpen is questionable. Jesse Orozco is a proven commodity, and Roger McDowell showed flashes of brilliance. But Ed Lynch can be erratic, and newcomers Bob Ojeda and Randy Neiman's effectiveness remain to be seen. The meat and potatoes of the Mets' offense is their power. Daryl Strawberry seems ready to become a legitimate superstar, while Hernandez, Carter, and Strawberry give the Mets one of the most devastating 3-4-5 spots in baseball. The supporting cast includes the infielders Howard Johnson, Rafael Santana, and Wally Bachman. A newcomer to keep an eye on is Kevin Mitchell, who plays third base and hits home runs. Mookie Wilson is injured. He'll be back. Rusty Staub will not. But with this pitching staff, the Mets should finally get over the top.
Not make a choice between a one-year suspension or complying with Baseball Commissioner Peter Ueberos' three conditions until an arbitrator rules on the matter. If his grievance is overruled, Hernandez, like the others, will have to contribute 10% of their salaries to drug prevention centers, submit to drug testing, and participate in community service. That's if they want to play this season. The players have until April 7th to file a grievance.
And when a decision is made by the arbitrator on the grievance, I will make my decision as to what action I will do, what decision I will make.
Besides paying a fine of 10% of his salary, Hernandez will have to spend at least 100 hours in drug-related community work and agree to random drug testing. This seems to be Ueberos' key victory.
Whether it's random drug testing, whether it's drug testing on specific days, but there's got to be something that proves.
Baseball, he'll be out some 6 to 7 weeks. Now here's Mookie being helped off the field, taken to the hospital. 21 stitches required around his eye and the bridge of his nose. So Mookie, who had the shoulder problem last season, sidelined again, which means Len Dykstra will be the Mets center fielder.
Shay, I was watching a Met game, well, prior to a Met game, was during BP, and I said, Mr. Foster, could you give me an autograph? And he walked by, and I said, Mr. Foster, please. I was the only one there. I mean, gracious, he could have gave me an autograph, and he didn't, so I told him about it. He owes me one.
Has he given you one yet today?
No, he's going to give me one before it's all over, though.
That is a little line. The guy couldn't mind up playing next to him. Couldn't get his autograph.
Mets win 6-4. Also, Bruce Brinney looks tough. There with Ron Reynolds again. 6-4, Mets beat the Reds. Yankees.
Three Rivers Stadium for a crucial three-game series against the then lowly Pittsburgh Pirates. The Mets, of course, were chasing the red-hot St. Louis Cardinals for the flag in the National League's Eastern Division. But in game one of that series, it was the Pirates, as the Mets were unable to handle the Buccos and suffered a major setback in their hopes for a National League Eastern Division title. Some power provided by George Foster. It was a brighter day for New York as the Mets' hopes stayed alive in the National League East. Game three saw the Mets look even better, as he has so often, Gary Carter provided the heroics for New York, and they went on to...
Dykstra hesitating at first and second, now being waved in. Khalifa slow to the plate, is not in time, and Dykstra scores. Hernandez goes to third, and the Mets lead 1-0.
For a lot of folks, including the ball girl, watch this, right down the first base line, should not have touched the drive by Howard Johnson, which cost the Mets.
I miscalculated, and I thought it was coming to me, and it wasn't. So,
is this the most embarrassing moment you've had?
The most. No, not the most, but close to it. I mean, on national TV.
Reynolds' first Pirate to bat hit it out, but Gooden did settle down. Sal Marciano discovered
it. Spoiling the debuts of the Bucks' new manager, new front office, new owners. 4-2 was the final, and pardon Mets skipper Dave Johnson if he feels no remorse over the outcome. Top of the first, Keith Hernandez, who's had, shall we say, an eventful offseason. Doubles home Len Dykstra, who beats the throw home, while Keith takes third, and it's 1-0 Mets. With a 2-0, Dwight Gooden faces his first batter of the year, and my, what a rude greeting from R.J. Reynolds. It's 2-1. Then in the sixth, George Foster loops one to right. Watch Joe Orsulak. Looks like he, I don't know, he's trying to down a punt or something. Darryl Strawberry scores, and it's 3-1. With it 4-2 in the ninth, runners at second and third. Gooden gets Tony Pena on a comebacker, and the Mets win it.
Since joining the Mets in 1982, the winter of 82, Danny Heap and I arrived with this ball club at the same time, and I don't think I've ever seen him hit a ball any harder than this. I can't believe this ball got out. It just kept carrying, 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 boom. I mean to tell you.
They won their third straight game today at Shea. Sid Fernandez pitched a two-hit shutout over eight innings. The Mets bombed the Phillies 8-0. First inning action here, Mets leading 1-0. Danny Heap, who started in left field, rips a shot deep to right with two men on base. It's gone. Three-run home run. Mets lead it 4-0. Fourth inning now. Keith Hernandez up for the Mets. Lines a shot to center field. Gary Maddox can't come up with the ball. Wally Backman comes in to score for the Mets, and they lead it 5-0. Sixth inning now. El Cid on second. Len Dykstra on first. Nobody gave the steal sign, but El Cid takes off. John Russell throws the ball into left field. Fernandez scores on the old double steal and error. 6-0 Mets. And on the mound, El Cid goes 8 complete innings, no runs, 2 hits, 6 strikeouts. Mets win 8-0. Roger McDowell provided perfect relief in the ninth inning. In other National League action, the Expos blank the Cards, so the Mets move within a game and a half of first place in the National League.
Let's go to the videotape, and this turned out to be an awfully big play, because in the third inning, with the Pirates leading 2-0, Sid Bream doubled in the right field. Strawberry up with the ball. Here comes Johnny Ray, and Ray is out at the plate. Now keep that in mind. 2-0 Pirates, bottom of the third, two outs, one on, and Gary Carter, boom, ties the game at 2-2. Now, 4-2 Pirates, one on, bottom of the eighth, and Ray Knight. Boom, there it goes. Home run, Ray Knight ties the game at 4-4. Take a bow, Ray. Come on out of that dugout. Bottom of the ninth, 5-5. Carter comes up again. Base hit, left field. Here comes Tuffle, who tied the game, doubling in Dykstra, and the Mets win it. 6-5.
Carter's two-out single scored Kevin Mitchell, who had walked and stolen. Carter with three key RBIs last night. Second inning, two walks and a Santana double. Preceded Keith Hernandez, slice, two-run double to left. Knight and Santana score. It was 3-0 with Keith very much into the game these days. The rain held things up for 49 minutes, and when they picked it up, the newest Met hero struck again. Ray Knight, whose two-run homer last night was so instrumental in that comeback win, pulls the hanging curveball by Ray Krawczyk over the left field wall, his fourth of the year already, as the Mets win their fifth straight and power into a tie for first with St. Louis as they sing in the rain at Shea. Well, it was...
back to McDowell, and that should do it. The throw to Keith Hernandez, and the Mets win it as McDowell comes through with some fine pitching, working the last two innings without giving up a base hit. His fielding play ends the ball game, and in 10 innings, the Mets win it by a score of 5-4. Davey Johnson and the Met coaches as the Mets get the victory here in St. Louis.
Last night to the Cards, George Foster drops the line drive by Jack Clark. A run scores, St. Louis took a 4-2 lead into the ninth. But Howard Johnson took care of that right quick with a two-run blast to right. It was a brand-new ball game, 4-4, on to extra innings. And that's where the Mets won it in the 10th. Foster redeeming himself with an RBI single, and the Mets stay in first place with a 5-4 win. Both New York teams are in first place, and when was the last time you could say that?
Now. They won their eighth straight today at the opening, at the expense, really, at the Cards, who lost their sixth straight. The Mets, 10-3, that record right now, their best start ever. Danny Cox started for the Cardinals, his first of the year. Lenny Dykstra says hello with a leadoff homer. Mets lead 1-0. They get three more in the first. Gary Carter drives in a run with a single. Then Danny Heap right here, a two-run single to right. That scores Carter and Strawberry. Mets lead 4-0. Thought that might be enough for Sid Hernandez, who had a one-hitter going into the ninth. But when McGee singled under Bachman's glove to start the ninth, Fernandez was gone and Roger McDowell was in. McDowell gave up a run-scoring double to Tommy Herr and then a run-scoring single to Jack Clark. Look at this baby, a line shot off the wall. Just a single for Clark, but a 4-3 game, nobody out. A fielder's choice, one out, then in comes Orozco. Pendleton hits one that looks for sure like it's going through, but Bachman right there gets to it, goes to second, relay to first. That's the game-ending double play. Mets win 4-3. Fernandez struck out 10. Cardinals have lost.
Man on, number 250 of his career, 4-0 Mets, 19 RBIs for Carter, leads the league. Darryl Strawberry, 5-for-5, including this opposite field home run. He raised his average 59 points tonight, up to 313. And how about Dale Murphy connecting for this home run as a pinch hitter? He wasn't supposed to play because of a hand injury in the lineup, only to extend his consecutive game streak, which is now 6-7-6. In fact, his first lifetime hit against White Gooden. Gooden went 8 to win. He's tonight's rare loss, beat the Reds 8-7. So the Mets have now won 12 out of the last 13, with the Reds now losing 6 straight, 10 of 11. Their fans would prefer to remain anonymous. Here is the play of the game. Tony Perez with a shot, and he is robbed by Wally Backman. Throws him out. Nice play by Wally Backman. And it was pitcher Roger McDowell who had his ups and downs on the mound, but he came through with this two-run single in the eighth inning, and this proved to be the game-winning hit. The Reds did come back. Watch this. Off a base hit by Eddie Milner, it is booted by George Foster right through his legs. It opened up a five-run inning, but the Mets hang on to win it 8-7. Mets now 14-4, while the Yanks...
about as much emotion as he's ever shown. Big moment of the game for the Mets. Ojeda, seventh inning, bases loaded. The Reds' big guy, Parker, at the plate. He embarrasses Parker. He pops out. That may have been the biggest pitch of the day.
They have a run through October. For the Mets, it was sweep me in St. Louis. The Cardinals were sitting pretty in the opener of their four-game set with the rival Mets. Ahead 4-2 after 8, they figured this game was...
Mets need a long ball. They might have it. This ball is out of here, and this game is tied. Oh, my goodness. So much for fate.
And so much for the Cardinals.
Top of the inning. Look out. He and Tuffle collide. Nobody hurt. Good thing, because in the bottom of the second inning, here's Strawberry. Look at this shot off of Nolan Ryan. What a clout. Deep into the bullpen, a two-run homer, his sixth of the year. Here's the game-saving play. Ray Knight at third. Ninth inning. Stops it from going to the outfield. That saved the tying run from scoring. Here's Orozco, all excited after the last out. He got the save. Sid Fernandez the win. He's 4-0. And the Yankees strive. Hey, nice
one. Two-run shot. 2-0 Mets in the third. In the fourth, little Lenny Dykstra gets around on a Ryan delivery, too. This one goes to the wall instead of over it. Ray Knight scores 3-0. The Mets behind Sid Fernandez's fourth win without a loss. Win it 3-2. At this hour in Seattle...
team happens to be the Mets, and they face Pete Rose and his Cincinnati Reds. On the mound for the Mets, Bob Ojeda. He allowed just one run, striking out 10. That ties his career high. Mets scored both of their runs in the sixth inning. Howard Johnson coming up with this big double to right field, and that scored Tim Tuffle. Lenny Dykstra then scored on a Darryl Strawberry sacrifice fly to give the Mets a 2-1 lead, and that held up thanks to this catch by Lenny Dykstra. Parker hits the ball deep to center field. Way back, watch Dykstra up, and he robs Dave Parker of what would have been a two-run home run, and that would have won the ball game for the Reds. And Dave Parker, boy, he just can't believe it, can he? Fabio Ojeda gets the 2-1 victory. He is 5-0 on the season. Now the Yankees.
It's a good night for both the Mets and Yanks out at Shea. The Mets turning it from yesterday's loss to the Reds by pulling one out, beating the Braves by the score of 1-0. Rough moment here, though, for Gary Carter on a foul pop. There goes Carter colliding with a fan and accidentally got drenched for his efforts. Strong outing for this man, Sid Fernandez, although he did not figure in the decisions. 10 strikeouts over 7 innings, Sid allowing only 4 base hits. The Mets had chances in the 7th to move in front. For example, George Foster robbed by Billy Sample. Nice catch by Sample, but the Mets pull it out. Bottom of the 9th, Tim Tuffle, who was criticized for not making the play in the field yesterday, came through with the RBI single. Ray Knight scores to break it up. After the game, Sal Marciano talked with Tuffle.
Right now, we're battling, and last night was unfortunate.
Bunt. Watch this, folks. Tim Tuffle,
Perfect bunt, third base, no play. Madlock watches it roll. He could watch it roll from now till Sunday.
Versus Hershiser, a pair of outstanding righties, and in the first inning, a pair of Dodger bonehead plays hurt Hershiser. With Hernandez on, Mariano Duncan throws Strawberry's grounder into Marin County, and the Mets get a break there. Then, Gary Carter with a weak swing grounds to Madlock, who proceeds to throw it in the dirt. Both Hernandez and Strawberry score, 2-0 Mets. Now in the bottom of three, the Mets still lead it 2-0. Well, the St. Louis Cardinals are off to a miserable start in defense of their pennant. Tommy Herr hitting only 167, robbed in a diving stab by Bob Horner, as the Cards can't win, no less, by a break. They fall to 13-18, 10 games back of the Mets. Pending tonight's outcome in L.A., of course, Virgil knocking in Ramirez off force. Redbirds lose their third.
Hernandez could not do it, but today the bullpen did it. The Mets stopped the Dodgers 8-4. The Davey Johnson shuffle had George Foster in left field today. Foster responded with two home runs. This is a three-run shot in the first inning. Randy Neiman came out of the pen to win his first major league game since 1982 when he was with the Pirates. The Dodgers helped, committing three more errors. Elsewhere in the National League, former Met Hubie Brooks' Grand Slam homer led the Expos over San Diego. The round tripper was Brooks' 10th this season.
Jumping in front early, then hanging in for a 7-4 victory. Mets with four in the first. Howard Johnson breaking an 0-for-16 with a two-run double. Hernandez and Strawberry score. Two hits for Johnson. Mets in front 4-0. In the third, hot-hitting Wally Backman with one of his three hits, a two-run double for Wally, who went 3-for-5. Mets now lead 7-1. They hold on to win it by the score of 7-4. The defensive play of the game, Ron Darling with the bunt. Third baseman Chris Brown with a nice diving catch. Darling again got the support today. He went 7, not a strong outing, but picked up the win. He is now 5-0. Mets 25-9, and Wally Backman says could be a runaway race.
I think by far we're the best club in this division, and you know, I'll say it right now that I believe if anybody can run away with it, the New York Mets can run away with it. And Montreal's a good ball club, but they're not near as good as we are.
All right, Mets now 4.5.
In San Francisco, and a four-run first pretty much decided things. Darryl Strawberry doubles to left off. Roger Mason, Mookie Wilson scores, so does Wally.
Between each other in the stands. The action on this game is in the field. Go to the top of the eighth. It's 2-1 San Diego. Darryl Strawberry singles to center field, scoring Wally Backman to tie the game at 2 for the Mets. And we go to extra innings in this one as well. Top of the 11th. A wild pitch decides it. Lance McCullers throws it. Allows Strawberry to score from third. Gives the Mets a 3-2 lead.
Let's go to the videotape. 1-1, bottom of the sixth. The Mets got five straight hits off Bobby Welch, including Backman doubled in the right field. Backman hitting 404 left-handed. Dykstra scores. The Mets led at this point 2-1. After Carter singled in Backman to make it 3-1, Tom Niedenfuhr came in to face Foster with the bases loaded. And the pitch to George, the second pitch from Niedenfuhr, boom. Foster's 13th career Grand Slam, home run number 339. Look at Niedenfuhr, 7-1 Mets. Niedenfuhr's next pitch to Ray Knight. Hits Knight, 6-2, 180. Niedenfuhr, 6-5, 230. Neither man was ejected from the ball game. The Mets win it 8-1. Darling all the way, allowed only five hits, struck out 12, walked only two. He is now 6-0. Right after the game, Doug Rubina first spoke to Knight, then Niedenfuhr, and then Tom Lasorda.
I'm sure he threw at me. I've always had the philosophy that I would never charge him out unless I knew it for sure. And after George hit the home run, I didn't really even think about it before, when I stepped in there. But as soon as he hit me, it all just happened, and I felt that he did it on purpose, sure.
Well, the one to Foster definitely was. It was just a pitch. I tried to come in on him, and he just turned and hit it down the line. I missed on that pitch, and I missed on the next pitch also.
So that's the first time I've ever seen a batter go after a pitcher and remain in the game. The only thing I'm disappointed in is the fan hit me in the face with a quarter, and I don't think that's right. When I come back from the bench, I had a lot of respect for these fans. I thought they were great fans.
All right, Tom Lasorda. Montreal beat the Padres 5-4, so the Mets still lead by 4.5. Yankees, who open on the West Coast, four hitter, but the bad news, Howard Johnson, broken forearm, could be out till July 1st. Let's go to the videotape. 1-0 Mets, bottom of the fourth, one on, Danny Heap up. Lamar Hoyt's 3-1 pitch. Boom, there it goes. Home run, 3-0.
Beating the Padres last night, 4-2. The story, Bruce Bereni and Roger McDowell allowing only two hits. So, you figure the Yanks and Mets allowed only three hits last night combined. Let's go to the videotape. 2-2, bottom of the eighth, Kevin Mitchell into the game. And Mitchell doubles over the bag into left field. Foster scores, and the Mets took the lead 3-2. Then bases loaded, one out. Tuffle comes in to pinch it. Ground ball to Templeton. The throw to second for one, but the throw to Garvey, too late. Knight scores, and the Mets win it 4-2. The Mets move on to Pittsburgh tonight. Ojeda against Kipper.
Five-game series. The Mets keep rolling. They beat the Pirates 7-0. Superb game pitched by Bob Ojeda. He went the distance, allowing only five hits. Ojeda is now 7-up and 2-down. And George Foster continues his power display. This with a man on in the second. His 10th home run of the season. 10 of his last 17 hits have been home runs. Mets broke it open with five in the fourth. Two on this base hit by the rookie Kevin Mitchell. Ojeda and Mookie Wilson score, and the Mets go on to win it 7-0. Bud Harrelson and his fellow coaches handling the team manager, Davey Johnson, attending his daughter's high school graduation. Mets running away and hiding the now 8.5 in front of Montreal on this fifth day of June. The Expos losing again tonight, their fifth straight loss. Phillies beating Montreal by the score of 7-3. It was Darren Dalton connecting for this three-run home run for the Phils, sparking a five-run first inning. Dalton's eighth of the year, and the Phillies have won 9 of their last 11. In the eighth inning, the Cardinals lead the Cubs 4-3. In the third on the coast, Braves 3 and the Padres 1.
Ray Knight, everything he does turns to gold. It's a bouncer up the middle with eyes. Base hit, make it 3-0. And the Mets keep rolling. Fourth inning, Ray Knight comes up again. Now look at Carlton's slider here. You can see the difference. It's a looping slider rather than the sharp one it used to have. And Knight really creams it to make it 4-1. Final 5-3. Darling with McDowell and Orozco in relief. No catching the Mets. Believe me. In St. Louis, the Expos over the Cardinals playing the sixth inning.
Carlton's great pitch.
Well, you know, I think when you're in a situation with Carlton, you just try to make contact. You know that he's been known for his slider, so you kind of somewhat put that in the back.
Around to score the first run of the ball game. In the second inning, with the Mets leading by a score of 3-0, Mookie comes up to lead off for the second time.
Good pitch. That pitch was up and in, and I just kind of fought it off. I'm not that strong, so my base running has always been something I've been very proud of, and I try to make the most out of my times at bat. That I'm on base because my own base percentage has been
done.
Ripped into right field, and here comes Mookie. Brown up with the ball, and the Mets win it 6-5. Darryl Strawberry's league-leading ninth game-winning RBI.
Well, it's a game-winning RBI, sure, but the confidence that it gives Darryl Strawberry to have that game-winning RBI against a left-handed pitcher. Breaking ball about shoelace high. Check it out. Well, that is a nasty pitch.
On this swing of the bat by Darryl Strawberry. Bill Robinson picking him up.
Getting a little scary here, Tom. The difference between the New York Mets and Montreal Expos is 13 games. That's the largest margin between a first and second place team at the All-Star break in 17 years. Offensively, New York leads the league in hitting. They've yet to be shut out. And they've got the best pitching staff in baseball. Also, keep in mind, most of the Mets players have better second halves of the season than first. This might be the year of the Mets, but today was Rusty Staub Day. Here with his mother, his fans welcomed him. So did his teammates, donning red wigs. Rusty was given an all-expense trip to Rome following the World Series, no doubt. Len Dykstra had the big day, though. Here with a leadoff triple off Doyle Alexander. Dale Murphy badly misplays this into a triple. And with Dykstra's speed, easily chugs into third. He later scored on Wally Backman's ground out in New York, led it 1-0. Top of the sixth, Dykstra now in the field, showing you some defensive prowess. Charges the ball. Ken Griffey coming plate word, and the throw by Dykstra, as you will see, right on the money. A great stop by Gary Carter, blocking the plate. Dykstra again, Doyle Alexander. This was not cheap. A home run for Dykstra. His fourth of the year. The Mets led it 2-0. His teammates can't even believe the power of this little guy. Ronnie Darling, his ninth win of the season here with the strikeout. He had 7 on the day. the final from Shea Stadium. The Mets 2-0 winners, and for Darling, his first shutout of the year. Cincinnati and Montreal, that game suspended in the sixth inning due to rain. They will pick it up July 24th. Now to Los Angeles. Time victory. Montreal has one of the best records in baseball, but they're 13 games back. Philadelphia, then Chicago, the National League champion Cardinals, 24 games out and out of it, and then the Pittsburgh.
Ball four. He walks in another run. The Mets have only had...
Well hit left field. It's going to be extra bases, and it hits the top of the wall. Dykstra scored. Here comes Backman. Strong throw home. He's going to be out.
Lead the league in pitching, lead the league in batting, have a six-game winning streak, and lead the division by 10.5 games. Now, as good as the Mets are, you don't need to give them a second chance, but that's what the Pirates do. Bill Allman says, I got it. Tony Pena says, I got it. No, you take it. Nobody has it. Second life for Hernandez. It proves to be costly. That inning, a big rally for the Mets. Kevin Mitchell off the left field wall. Len Dykstra scores easily. Wally Backman tries to score all the way from first. This time, Danny Khalifa nails him at the plate, but by then the Mets had enough runs to win. 4-1 the final in Game 2. In the second game, manager David Johnson gave Gary Carter a rest from behind the plate, but he kept in the lineup at first base, and Carter's bat came through. His 11th home run of the year, the Mets again have the lead. Who is behind the plate for the Mets? Well, a kid by the name of Ed Hearn, and he shows power of his own. The first home run and RBI of his career. The Mets in a doubleheader sweep. Pirates manager Jim Leyland has seen enough. He was ejected a short time later. The Mets are now 43-16. Jeff Reardon to the rescue again, his 15th save. But despite the win, Montreal still loses ground to the Mets. Montreal in second place, 10.5 games behind.
Just finding out what life is like in a division where one team is running away from everyone else, including the Cubs. That one team, of course, the New York Mets, and they didn't stop to give the Cubs any heat today. Now, Gene Michael is on the bench hoping the Cubs can pull it out and get his foot in the series. Forget it, Lenny Dykstra. Two-run homer, and the Mets lead it 2-0 early. Bottom of the fourth now. Some more long ball for the Mets. Sutcliffe, the pitcher, the pitch to George Foster, and a high curveball. He feasts off those kind of pitches. Sutcliffe went 6 1/3, gave up 4 runs and 7 hits all told. Now the Cubs come back with a little long ball of their own. Ron Say, he can still crank one when you get one right down in his wheelhouse, and that's what happened there. Say clears the left field fence, the 358 sign, with ease. That made it 3-1. The Cubs closed within one at 3-2, but George Frazier, he'd come on in relief. He'll uncork a wild pitch over to Queens, allows Wally Backman to score from third, and the Mets, as if they need it right now, get another victory. They are 10 up on Montreal, 18.5 up on the Cubs. They may well close it out by the All-Star break. By the way, Montreal beat Pittsburgh today 2-1. That game was played in Montreal. Vance,
he's come apart. The first place Mets took a pair this weekend in Chicago. They traveled to St. Louis with a 9.5 game lead. Even on a day when Dwight Gooden gave up 10 hits, the Mets won at Wrigley Field 7-4. Doc is 8 up and 3 down. Mets trailing 3-1 on the fifth. Darryl Strawberry belted a 2-run homer off Rick Sutcliffe, Cy Young Award winner just 2 years ago. The strawman 0-for-16 against Sutcliffe with 8 strikeouts before his 10th homer. In the Mets' sixth, George Foster broke a 3-3 tie with a solo blast, his 13th. The Mets ahead 4-3. They picked up 2 more runs to lead 6-3, and Strawberry jammed his right heel stealing. He had to limp off with a slight sprain.
And Mookie Wilson on the move.
There's a line drive. A great effort by Mookie Wilson. Holy cow! Line drive, base hit to center. Mookie Wilson up and throwing. Here comes the throw. He's out.
And the Cubs are out for good when Gary Carter sparked a 6-run seventh inning as the Mets took the opener. Meta Rays grew faint next day, though, as Chicago offense held sway. Calling up memories of their 1984 rivalry, the Cubs dominated the Mets and after 3.5 innings led 6-2. But the Mets turned Chicago's lead into a brief encounter. New York quickly came back with 3 runs and then in the sixth tied the score. However, Rollick and Frolick fizzled out in the ninth inning when Keith Moreland, a main nemesis of 2 years ago, did in the...
Today to the Cubs for minor leaguers Dave Linderman and David Little. So much for the arbiter's ruling that gave Lynch more money than Ron Darling. Now, on the field, the Mets are in St. Louis tonight, and because ABC TV does not allow us to use video, let me
finish. In the left center field, and Mitchell will be waved in. He'll score to make it 5-0 as Hernandez stops at second. That's so true if you're a veteran.
First of the three-game set, the Mets continue their winning ways. They beat the Cardinals by the score of 7-0. The one St. Louis bright spot, Vince Coleman running wild. Four stolen bases tonight is 49 on the season. The Mets jumped on John Tudor. Here's Kevin Mitchell putting it out. It goes into the basket in left center. Fourth home run of the year, making it 4-0. They win it 7-0. Another good one for Bob Ojeda. Ojeda making it a record of 9 up and 2 down. The Mets remaining 9.5 in front of the Cubs.
Of the two ball clubs, Mets lead the National League in runs scored with 372.
Divisional divinity. But ever since they perceived themselves as pennant contenders, they've plummeted, dropping 7 of 8 games. Their acquisitions had an accent on pitching. But for the last week, the Atlanta staff has given up 8 runs a game. One thing working in their favor, it couldn't get any worse, could it? Well, for the second straight night in New York, the Braves took a shellacking, shall I say. And Rick Aguilera did in their own inept hitters. Started off the game with a strikeout of Andres Thomas. It has not been a good season for Aguilera, but quite an after rainy afternoon for him in New York. Two on, bottom of the third, and the Mets go to work on Rick Mailer. Keith Hernandez drives this ball just past Bob Horner, gets all the way to the corner. Aguilera will score. Two runs score on the play. Lenny Dykstra trots home, and Hernandez beats the throw to third, and not a very good throw at that. He comes all the way home. The Mets are off to their rump. By the fifth, Mookie Wilson is on first. Jeff Deadman is on in relief. Wilson takes off. Speaking of bad throws, Ozzie Virgil bounces one past Hubbard this time. Now Dale Murphy will try to nail Wilson at third, and he bounces one past Obergefell again. It was a comedy of errors for Atlanta. 4 on the day, and their hitting was not any better. 10-1 Mets. They've been outscored 26-2 in 3 games in New York. At Olympic Stadium, Montreal.
Thing for the Mets, they fight on the field as well as off the field. Let's go to the videotape. Last night's game, 3-1 Cincinnati. Game should have been over right here. 2 on, 2 out. Parker back, says, I've got it. No, he drops the ball. Dykstra scores, Tuffle scores, 3-3. Bottom of the 10th, Eric Davis steals third, runs into Ray Knight. Knight and Davis go at it, and Ray Knight says, take a right hand, here it comes, boom! There they go, Mitchell, Knight, Soto, and Davis all ejected from the game. And look who's playing the outfield for the Mets, Jesse Orozco in right field. Who's in left field? Roger McDowell, because of the ejections. Top of the 14th, power comes in, and Howard Johnson says, I'll show you power. Boom, there it goes, 3-run homer, 6-3 Mets. Tonight, Darling goes against last year's Rookie of the Year, 20-game winner Tom Brown. Williams and third baseman Chris Brown all ejected. The Cardinals won 10-7.
Parker's play on the mound. Then the fireworks in the 10th inning. Eric Davis, stolen base, words with Ray Knight, bit of shoving, and Knight nails him with a right hand. The bench is empty. 5 ejections overall. Everyone piled into the act. Then Kevin Mitchell and Mario Soto go at it on Live at 5.
It's the biggest lead a National League team has had in 10 years. And a good game for Rick Aguilera. And check this out for the batters for the Mets. In the third inning, Gary Carter, 2 on. He hits a 3-run homer off Rick Mailer. That made it 3-0 Mets. Then Darryl Strawberry, the next batter, he hits a homer. So now it is 4-0 Mets. And the next batter, Kevin Mitchell, and one more time. Back-to-back-to-back homers for just the fourth time in Mets history. That's all they scored today. Even Mailer on the mound thought it was kind of funny. But the Mets have to be thrilled with Rick Aguilera. This is his first complete game of the year, so the Mets get a big game from their fifth starter. 5-1 the final after the Braves swept them last night.
Now, Bandits over the million mark. They saw the Mets strike with a fury in the third. With 2 on, Gary Carter laid into a high fastball from Rick Mailer and belted it out. A 3-run poke that broke the seal on scoring. Complete game pitching of Rick Aguilera to victory, and now lead the East, and the lead balloons to 16 games there.
into third place in the East, 18 and one half games out of first. The Mets lead 1-0 in the seventh, and Bob Ojeda was working on a no-hitter, but rookie Luis Rivera, just up from AAA, laces a clean single to right to break up the no-hit bid. The first major league hit for Rivera. After a ground out by Tim Reyes, Andre Dawson lines a single to center. Rivera will come around and score from second. He's saying there's nothing to this major league stuff. We're tied 1-1 in the eighth with two Mets on. Ray Knight rips one down the line. Keith Hernandez will score on this. Tim Raines out there having a bit of a problem coming up with it. Then he has some trouble throwing it. Heap scores. 3-1 Mets. But in the ninth, with Expos at second and third, Andre Dawson hits a grounder to short that takes a bad hop over Santana's head. Two-run score, tied again at three. But in the tenth, it's Mr. Ray Knight again. This time, he's going to step up and just get one into right field. Wally Backman will motor home from second. Mets win it, 4-3 and 10. And that's the way it stood. It
ended with Foster not producing and being relegated to pinch-hitting duties. He had been replaced in left field by Kevin Mitchell. And despite the fact that both players are black, Foster was quoted as saying that his demotion was racially motivated so that the Mets could call up Lee Mazzilli, a white player, to replace him. Foster backtracked on that in an interview earlier today.
It wasn't a racial situation. It was more of a business decision as it came down to it. But I still enjoy playing in New York, even though I didn't put the stats on the board as I would have liked. And it was disappointing not only to the fans, but to myself. But as it turned out, it worked against me having that bigger lead, because if we had a 3 or 4 game lead, I felt I would have still would have been there. They would have, wouldn't have gone with the younger guys, and they would have gone with the veterans, because they had been through it before. But as it turned out, they had that cushion to work with to see it doesn't have to be their way, and I just have to strive to stay strong.
Waivers will clear, incidentally, by next Tuesday, at which point anybody can pick up his contract for $1, according to the rules of baseball, or he can become a free agent and then is free to sign with any ball club that he wishes.
Mazzilli was back with the Mets for today's games in Chicago. He was a Mets All-Star in 1979 and was recently released by Pittsburgh. Needless to say, he's happy to be back with the team.
You know, you're released from a ball club 2 weeks ago, and now you're back with a team that's a pennant contending, a team that's going to win the World Series, a chance to win, and you're back in the big leagues. What can I say? Frank and the New York Met organization gave me the opportunity, so I'm privileged to be back in New York, and that's the truth.
George Foster.
All right, Rollin, 37-year-old George Foster apparently criticized the Mets and was hitting only .227, 13 homers, only 38 RBIs, was released tonight by the Mets. And the Mets have brought up Lee Mazzilli. One of the problems, through no fault of George's, the fans knew he was making $2 million per year. And he never had a $2 million year with the Mets. I don't think anybody's ever had a $2 million season. However, don't feel too bad for George. The Mets must still pay his full $2 million salary for the rest of the year. Foster's best year with the Mets, 83, when he had 28 homers and 90 RBIs. 21,000 at the stadium tonight. The Yankees beat them, no decision. Second game, 6-4 Mets. However, it was suspended after 7 innings darkness. They'll finish tomorrow. Let's go to the videotape of the first game. Keith Hernandez, 5-for-7 in the doubleheader. Boom, home run in the top of the first of his old friend and former teammate Eddie Lynch. Now 5-3 Mets, bottom of the ninth, one on, one out. Gooden's pitch to Jody Davis ties the game at 5-5, but top of the 12th, after a big error by George Frazier, Mookie went 3-for-7, base hit. Hernandez scores. Carter right behind him, 7-5, and the Mets won it 7-6. Now, in the second game, the big hit, top of the fifth, 4-2 Mets, one on, and boom, Carter with his 18th made it 6-2. It's 6-4 after 7, darkness. Steve Carlton, who's a shoe-in for the Hall of Fame, called it quits tonight after 22 years in the majors.
They're saying that it seemed as though every time a player of his caliber is replaced, it's a more popular white player who's chosen. Mets manager Davey Johnson was asked his reaction before this afternoon's doubleheader in Chicago.
I'm very saddened about it and also mad at the same time. I talked to George after I learned of it when the bus got back to the hotel, and I asked him if he thought that, you know, I was, my decisions on who I played were racially motivated, and he said, no, it's just out of context. And he didn't elaborate on it. I wanted him to clear up the matter, but he left it at that. So it's just a sad thing, and it's something that upsetting to me, thinking that I might do something like that. like him very much personally, and for this to come up, it's a shock and saddening to me, and it's something I can't condone and I can't have.
Apparently, the Mets couldn't have it. After he struck out in Game 1 and skipped the end of the suspended game, Foster was put on waivers by the Mets. He has let go with a .275 career average and is 37th on the all-time home run list, including the 52 he smacked in 1977 in winning the National League MVP honors. The Mets have finally fulfilled his five-year contract and will replace him on the roster with Lee Mazzilli. But the man who took his job is Kevin Mitchell, a 300-hitting rookie who is black. There is Foster in the dugout with Daryl Strawberry, sulking before...
Len Dykstra singles to right, Howard Johnson, and Rafael Santana scored. Dwight Gooden ends up at third. He would score on a sack fly, 4-3 Mets. Top of the eighth, Mookie Wilson bounces one up the middle. Sean Dunston with the fine effort, but he can't turn the double play. Len Dykstra scores, 5-3 Mets. Gooden cruising into the ninth, leading 5-3, but with one on, Jody Davis gets hold of the low fastball of 7-6. McDowell, the winner.
His mission? Keep the score tied despite three on and Gary Carter up.
And the Goose strikes out Gary Carter with the bases loaded in the ninth inning.
Then last of the ninth, two out, two on, and the league's leading hitter at bat. Clout in the clutch for Gwynn, who turned mission improbable into mission accomplished. Next game, the Padres put on a shower of power, but Met defense soon shut off the flow. Down by a run, the Padres mounted a second straight uprising, but in the ninth, Jesse Orozco and his troops had a counterinsurgency plan. Answering the call to arms, Orozco put down the revolt as New York held on for the win.
Goes against Fernando Valenzuela. Last night, the Mets won 4-2 as Dwight Gooden turned it around with a solid effort, and rookie Kevin World B. Mitchell, as teammates are now calling him, whacked this two-run home run in the sixth inning. Sal Marciano talked with Mitchell after the game.
He got that pitch up where I can see it well, and I got a good piece of the bat on it.
You feel more relaxed?
Yeah, I feel good now, you know. I feel more confidence now. I guess maybe tomorrow I might hit another one.
Dwight Gooden went all the way, struck out 10, gave up 5 hits. 2 of the hits were homers, but a satisfying effort after pitching coach Mel Stottlemyre made a minor adjustment.
We didn't really cut down his leg kick. I modified it a little bit, mainly just so that he'd sit back and try to make his good pitches rather than, you know, to try to overthrow, which I felt like he'd been doing in a couple of previous games. It wasn't a major thing, but it was just something that we had to work on, and he worked extra hard this time to try to get back into the groove, and I think he's on his way now.
For the most part, I thought that Dwight had an excellent outing, and as far as I'm concerned, the doctor's back.
He was loaded, and in that situation with Baron Guerra, I was looking fastball all the way, and he threw me 4 or 5, but he was really just probably the best fastball I've seen all year, and I was just battling, trying to make contact, and he finally got one in, and I got the pretty good part of the bat on it. But it was really, I was elated. It was great to always do something.
And Keith Hernandez scoring the tying run. Singles into left field, and the Mets get the first run of the ball game. Backman had walked, moved on down, and the Mets get a run as the third. Chili Davis gets this bloop single. Bob Brenly, who had singled, and Jeff Leonard, New York Mets. And coming into the ball game to replace Brenly was Aguilera. Now right here in the bottom of the third inning, George Foster takes it deep downtown over the left field fence for George, his 7th home run, and the Mets are leading by a score of 5-4. And Chili Davis comes up, and Chili, some sort of a hitter against the New York Mets. He gets a home run here, his 5th of the year, his 2nd as a left-hand batter, and that makes it a 6-5 ball game in favor of the Mets as Chili Davis continues to hit the Mets well. Rick Aguilera, the pitcher at that point in the ball game. In the top of the 8th inning, the Giants come back. Roger McDowell is on the mound. A great play right here. Rob Thompson comes up against Jesse Orozco. He has had only one home run in the major leagues. This is home run number 2, and it puts the Giants on top by a score of 7-6. But it wasn't over. In the bottom of the 10th inning, Ray Knight leads off with a single. After an out and a wild pitch with Hernandez on at third. Ray Knight hits it. And right here, a pop-up. It should be a tie ball game in the ball game going into extra innings into the 11th. But they run together out there. Uribe giving an error in the play. Mitchell, who had pinch hit for Strawberry, comes in to score. Mitchell had single for Darryl Strawberry. A big move by Davey Johnson in the ball game, and the Mets win it by a score of 8-7.
It's ever happened to me there when that ball went foul. I knew I had hit it hard enough to go out, and then the next pitch, I just said, just try to be quick. Don't try to overswing. And he threw another pitch out over the plate, and when it went out of the ballpark, I actually thought Andre Dawson caught this ball. It looked like he did, and when I was rounding the bases, I was saying to myself, geez, I don't believe that happened.
Now, that's your last Major League home run. Any thoughts when you're going around the bases? Do you think it might be your last?
No, not at that time. You know, I never really tried to pre-think anything like that. I was just so pleased to be able to have put us ahead at that time. It put us ahead 3-2 in the game. We actually scored another run in that inning, but later in the game, they tied it up, and we lost that game in extra innings.
Well, you had some more great days. Early Rusty Staub, the Houston Colt 45s.
That was a real experience for me. I was not the Mets. I imagine he went back down one time, very tough time, I guess, during 69. When they were winning, I think, was one of the years that he might have had to go down a little bit. I'm not sure about that.
Right.
But he's...
Detroit and Texas, played over 400 games with four clubs. There you are with Houston. A base hit right there. Rusty, here you are as a Montreal player. Hey, you look awful young right there. This is Detroit. Another base hit for Rusty, playing for the Tigers at that time. And now the Texas Rangers. A lot of nostalgia right there, Rusty. Of course, you played with the New York Mets.
Runs and four RBIs for Knight, who raised his batting average to .421. Dwight Gooden was up to his old tricks, raising his record to 3-0, while Gary Carter pulled off a neat trick of his own. All that gave the Cards their third shutout loss in five games. Next day, the Mets continued their bang-up offense, exploding for four runs in the first inning. Not quite what Danny Cox had in mind for his first game back from injury. The Mets raised their hit total to 34 in three games and their team batting average to .289, best in the league. Who boosted his record to 3-0, and the Mets swept the series for their ninth straight win while handing the Cards their seventh straight loss. Astronomical. 10 wins in 12 games and the best in the West. But efforts to juggle... John Tudor ended his stretch of 18 straight regular season wins at home when the Cards lost to the Mets, the same team that beat Tudor before he began the streak.
Soto deep to center field. This one is gone. Darryl's fourth on the year. Soto's ninth gopher ball on the year as well. Reds off to a rocky start as they try to stop a seven-game slide. Now also in the first inning, Gary Carter on second base. Ray Knight continues his torrid offensive pace. The base hit to left. Carter coming around to score, and the Mets lead by a score of 3-0. Now, inning number three, Soto still on the hill. Strawberry ready to pounce and does it to right. It's gone. Second homer of the game for Darryl, his 10th multi-home run game of his career. And the Mets in front comfortably by a score of 4-0. Top of five, Mets add to that lead. Danny Heap, base hit right field. Wally Backman around to score. This makes it 5-0. The Mets win 7-2 to sweep the series. They've now won 14 of their last 15 ball games. Back now, Al Michaels.
Lewis earlier in the year, who would have guessed Houston would be the best the rest of the league had to offer, or that Dwight Gooden would be out to equal the victory total of Bob Knepper? But that's the way it stood. Knepper pitching a beauty against Gooden, losing 1-0 in the bottom of the seventh when Gooden breaks it open.
He earlier had just missed a home run. This time, drives it over Terry Poole's head. George Foster, who had homered for the only run of the game earlier, scores easily, and Gooden knocks in two runs, 3-0. It's 4-0 by the time Gooden faces his first jam of the game. Jose Cruz at the plate should be an easy pop-up, but Tuffle goes back, Strawberry comes in, and never the gloves and leather should meet with the ball. Suddenly the bases are loaded, and Houston's power hitter Glenn Davis with a chance to bring his team all the way back, but he taps right back to the mound. Gooden turns it into a 1-2-3 double play, gets the congratulations from Gary Carter, and why not? He's 5-0 now. The shutout gives him a 1.04 ERA. Knepper falls to 5-1, while the Mets have won 10 of 11. Montreal is in second place, still clinging.
Bill Robinson. He just hung right in there and tried to get a piece of the ball and sends it right back up the middle. Carmen has no chance. On the artificial surface, it's through there. And Ray Knight really hustling. Head first slide across home plate.
Mets doing a lot of hitting. 13 base hits. Fastball, and that's hit to left and deep. Back goes Reedus, and it's off the wall. One run is in. Dykstra stops at third, and into second goes Tuffle with a long double. 7-4 Mets.
Here was the first one, bottom of the first. 2-1 Phils, bases loaded, and Ray Knight comes through with a base hit right field. Hernandez scores, Carter right behind him. The Mets led 3-2 and never trailed. Bottom of the seventh, bases loaded, two outs. Foster comes up. And Foster inside the line by Wilson. Hernandez scores. Carter scores. 5-2 Mets. 1,200 RBIs for Foster. In Fenway, the Red Sox beat Tom Seaver and the White Sox 2-1.
Says, take this one, Ron. This is way back. Home run. Thompson's first of the year at 1-0 Phils. One out later, still top of the first. The pitch to Mike Schmidt. Boom! He goes down and gets it. Back goes Lynn Dykstra. Back. He leaves. He can't get it. 411-foot homer. 2-0 Philadelphia. Bottom of the first, though. Steve Carlton has given up a bases-loaded walk. Bases still loaded. Hernandez and Carter again on base. Again scoring. Two-run shot for Foster. Gives the Mets the 5-2 lead. And they go.
They came into tonight's meeting with first place in New York, 16 and a half games out of first.
Hold a 20-game lead in the NL East by mid-August, which means the rest of the division can mail in the rest of this season. The Mets had a suspended game to complete against the Cubs today, plus the regularly scheduled game, and the New Yorkers claimed both at Wrigley Field. First, the suspended game from yesterday's doubleheader. To continuation, the Mets came in leading 6-4 in the ninth at 7-5. Mets, Ryan Sandberg, the slow roller. Chris Beyer scores, 7-6, nobody out. Bob Dernier, the next hitter, Doug Sis, gets him the bunt in the air. Keith Hernandez touches it, and he is in fair territory. Why the Cubs thought it was a foul ball, no one knows. But Hernandez recovers, throws to Tim Tuffle to get Dernier, and the fire down to second base makes it a double play. Acting manager John Vukovic came on while Gene Michael serves a three-game suspension. But umpire Paul Runge says, I don't care what you say, it's a double play. Jesse Orozco came on, threw one pitch, and got pinch hitter Jody Davis to fly out to Kevin Mitchell in right field to end the game. And the suspended game went to the Mets. The final 7-6. Anderson, the winner. Steve Trout took the loss, and Jesse Orozco with that one pitch, save number 15. On to today's regularly scheduled game. Top of the fourth inning, the Mets leading 1-0 against Scott Sanderson. Make that 4-0. Gary Carter drives home run number 19 of the year. Watch the mass of humanity go after the baseball here. 83 RBIs on the year for Carter, 4-0 Mets. In the sixth, it was 4-2. Danny Heap gets into the act against Sanderson. Home run number 4 of the year will clear the ivy in right field and land amongst the Cub fans. The solo shot makes it 5-2 New York. And then the Mets just blew it wide open in the eighth. Bases loaded. Ray Knight, a drive in the left field. He went 4-for-5 today. A two-run single gets Gary Carter and Mookie Wilson home. That made it 8-2. Two more runs cross the plate, and then Frank DePino on in relief. Keith Hernandez, a base hit to get Ray Knight home to cap a six-run inning, and New York was up 11-2. The rest was easy for Rick Aguilera. He gets Jody Davis on strikes here to end it all. Aguilera struck out six, walked nobody, won his sixth decision in a row. He is 6-3 on the year. The Mets win it 4.
Those ideas were buried in their unconscious by the New Yorkers, who beat them 7-2 to go up by 18 games. In the process, Sid Fernandez got his team-leading 13th win of the season. Mets 1, Montreal nothing, fourth inning. Fernandez to Van Slaw, who grabs hold and drives it deep to left field. It is gone. A home run ties the game at 1. Now the Mets are down 2-1 in the seventh. Danny Heap pinch hitting for Fernandez. lines a base hit to the opposite field. Hearn, on his way to the plate, scores. The game is tied at two. But here's the big one. Wally Backman. Would you believe this? Way over Tim Raines' head. That double scores Heap. Lenny Dykstra, 4-2 now. Keith Hernandez with a base hit makes it 5-2 in favor of the Mets. Rick Anderson was absolutely superb in relief. Tim Wallach's fly into the ballgame. It was 7-2 by this time. The Mets are up by 18 games. Bring on the West.
Well, the Mets were once again the focal point of Monday Night Baseball on ABC. It's as if there's no one else worth watching with that network. They have them on every Monday. Darryl Strawberry had been in a slump. He was 0-for-24. He went into Los Angeles in the region in which he grew up. A base hit drove in a run there. Keith Hernandez hit a home run that was, well, over the fence. Then we'll show you the one that Strawberry hit was even further. So Strawberry's out of his slump. The Mets have been in somewhat of a malaise of late with that big lead. It's kind of hard to stay sharp, I guess, when you're leading your division by 17 games. That made it 5-0. The final score was 5-4 as the New York Mets beat the Dodgers last night. The Dodgers' Bill Russell with a base hit there made the score 5-4, but the Met bullpen held the fort last night.
And two, again, the runners in motion. And a drive to right, a base hit. One run scores, and another. Lead 4-0. Mookie down to second, and he beats the throw. So Mookie on the 3-2 pitch drives in two big runs for the Mets.
Hernandez with two out rips this double past Greg Brock to start the rally against those struggling Dodgers. Then Kevin Mitchell, the very next batter, creates another credential for his Rookie of the Year award, cranks a two-run homer, his 11th. That curveball pulled just inside the foul pole. Mets jump to the early lead now in the second. It is
probably didn't help their mood any tonight when a pitcher they dismissed from their own organization was on the mound for the Mets looking for his 14th win, Sid Fernandez. Second inning, no score, two outs, bases full for Sid Fernandez, who singles through Dennis Powell's legs. That brings in both Ray Knight and Ed Hearn, and the Mets lead 2-0. And then it's Mookie Wilson looking to do some further damage, sending a drive to left center field, but Jose Gonzalez makes the nice diving backhanded stab to end that inning. 4-0 now in the fourth, and Joe Beckwith came on in relief. Keith Hernandez, the batter, and Hernandez comes through with a base hit to right field, bringing in another couple of runs as Hernandez and Wilson score, and the Mets out on top by the score of 6-0. Looks like an easy win, but in the bottom of the fifth, L.A. has scored twice, two gone. Mike Marshall with only three hits in his last 52 at-bats with a blast to right field with two aboard, three-run homer, and that cut the lead to 6-5. Then a pivotal play in the eighth following a leadoff single. Enos Cabell bunting, and Hernandez comes up with it and forces Len Matusik at second. Called out. He looked safe there, and L.A. comes up empty in the inning as New York gets the insurance run in the ninth, and the Mets go on to beat the Dodgers once again. The final was 7-5. Fernandez getting the win. Powell the loss, and Jesse Orozco with his 17th save this season. Meanwhile, New York Mets pitcher Ron Darling and second baseman Tim Tuffle were indicted today in Houston on charges of aggravated assault. The charges stem from a July 19th incident at a Houston night.
The Giants jumped on Mets starter Rick Aguilera, put the first two men on in the first. Then Candy Maldonado ripped into a breaking ball and sent it soaring to left and over the fence for a 3-0 San Francisco lead. Meanwhile, Giants starter Mike Kruko was helping himself. Watch this reflex action on the soft liner directed at him. In the fifth, Maldonado got a hold of a low fastball and singled to drive in his fourth run and stake San Francisco to a 4-1 lead. And then in the seventh, Maldonado fought off Doug Sisk's attempt to jam him and squibbed one to right. Guys with only 65 hits this season. More importantly, the Giants made a move to get back into contention and stop the Mets' winning streak at six.
Last place. Well, the Mets got a run in the first in this one with Lynn Dykstra on third, Keith Hernandez on first, Gary Carter bouncing one to third, Tim Wallach guns Carter out, but Dykstra scores and the Mets are up 1-0. Good play there. New York adds to its lead in the fifth. Gary Carter up, and he lines one the other way. Wally Backman scores. Hernandez will come around to score. Here comes Hernandez around third. He's going to score, and Carter's going to get Yes, a triple. The big guy motors around and takes a dive. 3-0 Mets. And when things are going right, Lynn Dykstra lifts the fly to left center. Mitch Webster and Tim Raines out there. Watch this play. What play? Dykstra would score on a sacrifice fly. And Rick Aguilera had a strong outing. 7 strikeouts, including Tim Wallach here. Wallach's bat is out of hand, and so is the National League East race. They had a problem getting this one finished. It was a rain delay of 1 hour and 22 minutes in the ninth inning, but they finally got it finished, and the Mets lead by 17 and a half games in the East.
That felony charges of resisting an officer with violence in a December 13th altercation with Tampa police. If found guilty, the former Cy Young Award winner could face a 5-year prison sentence.
Magic number stood at 2, leaving the Mets in need of only one victory over the Phillies to clinch the title. Thousands of Mets fans traveled to Philly to cheer their heroes. And as it turned out, the Mets got off on the right foot.
1969, and Lenny Dykstra on the first pitch hits it out of sight. It is gone. Goodbye. Into the upper deck.
Listen to this place. It's like Shea Stadium. But suddenly, the big Met machine forgot how to win. The fielders forgot how to catch. The pitchers forgot how to keep the ball in the park. And the Phillies forgot how to lose as they swept the 3-game set from the Mets. After splitting a pair in St. Louis, the Mets headed back to Shea in search of that elusive clinching victory. Dwight Gooden got his second shot at the clincher, and he got some help from an unexpected source. Rookie Dave Magadan. Starting in place of an ill Keith Hernandez, Magadan had 3 hits along with the game-winning RBI back on top in the 7th. Lenny Dykstra came to the plate in the 9th inning with 1 out and Wally Backman on 2nd and promptly took reliever Dave Smith downtown for a 6-5 Mets victory. Game 4 featured the second installment of the Mike Scott Show as the Astros ace mastered the Mets by a 3-1 count. The Mets didn't have much better luck with Nolan Ryan in Game 5 until Darryl Strawberry tied the score at 1 with this homer down the right field line. That's the way it stood until the 12th inning when Gary Carter got his second game-winning RBI of the series with this single up the middle for a 2-1 Mets victory. Rather than have to face Mike Scott again in Game 7, the Mets knew they had to try to clinch the series in Game 6. However, they trailed 3-0 in the 9th inning before Dykstra once again got things going with a triple up the gap. Mookie Wilson, Keith Hernandez, and Ray Knight followed with RBI singles, and the game was tied at 3. The Mets pulled ahead in the 14th, but Billy Hatcher tied it once again on this homer. Finally, the Mets put it out of reach with 3 runs in the 16th and some gutsy pitching by Jesse Orozco to hold on for a 7-6 win. After the Mets' draining victory in Game 6, a very relieved Frank Cashin and Gary Carter had some interesting things to say about the intensity of that championship series.
I had one definite thing that was in my mind, Fran, and that was that we're going to have to win it here. We're going to have to win it today, because if we had lost that game in extra innings, 15, 16 innings, to Houston, then the momentum would all gone to Houston. They're coming back to their home park. They got their ace pitcher. They just won a spine-tingling 15, 16-inning game. So I knew that we had to win this game, which is why I think Davey, who also knew, and left Roger McDowell out there for 5 innings, got 5 superb innings from him, and really got some great pitching from Ojeda after that first inning. And in my opinion, some of those balls could have been caught, and, you know, it could have been a different kind of ball game. But that's what makes baseball great. It's those games of inches and those little different, the positioning of the players at a certain time when the ball goes through, the nuances of the game that you can go back and express and think about and talk about ad infinitum.
I felt that this series was so draining. I mean, it was every pitch, every play was so meaningful. I mean, you could never ease up at any time. There was never a blowout at all or anything. And it was just a total team effort all the way through. And that's really the only way I can describe. And I'm just so elated and happy. I mean, I don't have enough adjectives to describe how great it is to go to the World Series.
Now it was back home to battle the Bo Sox in the series.
In Game 1, Tim Tuffle made this error to allow the game's only run, as Bruce Hurst topped hard luck king Ron Darling 1-0. In Game 2, the Mets got to Boston ace Roger Clemens for 3 runs in 4 1/3 innings. But it wasn't enough, as the Sox clobbered Dr. K for 6 runs in 5 innings. By virtue of the 9-3 pacing, the underdog Bo Sox headed home with a comfortable 2-0 lead in the series. That lead quickly was cut to 2-1 as Bobby Ojeda stifled his ex-mates for a 7-1 Met win in Game 3. Darling had another strong outing in Game 4, and this time he got some help from Gary Carter, who hit 2 monstrous homers to spark the Mets to a 6-2 triumph. In Game 5, the Red Sox again feasted on Gooden's pitching, with 9 hits and 4 runs in only 4 innings. On the other side, Game 1 winner Bruce Hurst closed the door on the Mets, this time by a 4-2 margin, and the Sox were 1 win away from a world championship. The first 9 innings of Game 6 were far from a thing of beauty. There were errors galore, runners thrown out at the plate, strategical mistakes, and enough botched opportunities to send the game into extra innings tied 3-3. The Sox finally appeared to have shaken the World Series jinx that haunted them for so long when they broke through for a pair of runs off Rick Aguilera in the 10th. No team in World Series history had ever come back from 2 runs down in extra innings to win. And when Bachman and Hernandez went down to start the inning, it looked like the Mets wouldn't either. Slowly, the miracle at Shea took form. Gary Carter started it off with a single and scored 2 batters later on a single by Ray Knight. Kevin Mitchell, who had a pinch hit single, moved to third on Knight's hit, only 90 feet away from tying the game. Bob Stanley replaced the shaken Calvin Schiraldi on the mound. Ghosts of World Series past came back to haunt the Sox again, as Stanley sailed this one inside to bring Mitchell home with the tying run. Then Mookie Wilson hit this harmless grounder down the first baseline that went toward Bill Buckner's outstretched glove and just kept right on going. And so did Ray Knight, all the way home with the winning run. After Game 6, Game 7 was almost anticlimactic. Again, the Mets had to come from behind, and they did it with 3 runs in the 6th off a tired Bruce Hurst. 1 inning later, Ray Knight continued the assault with this shot, and the Mets added 2 more for a 6-3 lead. But the Sox wouldn't die as they clawed back for 2 in the 8th. Darryl Strawberry answered with this mammoth homer, and Jesse Orosco, that's right, Jesse Orosco chipped in another with an RBI single. Then Jesse went out to the mound and shut down the Sox 1-2-3, and the New York Mets had their 2nd World Championship. Well, the Mets winning the World Series certainly was one of the highlights of the 1986 sports year. But there were plenty of other great moments as well. Coming up, we'll take a look at the rest of the year in sports. So stay with us.